I've spoken before about why probability is so important to machine learning. Some of that has to do with modeling noise, some of that has to do with representing uncertainty, but some of it has to do with representing structure and data via joint probability distributions. But those distributions can only be interesting if they capture dependence between random variables. To understand what that means, we must first talk about independence. Intuitively, independence between random variables is the idea that the two random variables don't influence each other. That is, that if I had information about one, that it really wouldn't tell me anything about the other. Formally, what that means is that the joint distribution over the two random variables factorizes into two pieces. Each of the two pieces is just a distribution over one of the variables. This also implies that the two conditional distributions are equal to their marginals. This is consistent with our intuition that knowing one of the variables doesn't tell us anything about the other. Independence also means that the expectation of the product of the two random variables is equal to the product of the expectations. Let's have a look at what independence might mean in a simple bivariate PMF. Here, the random variable y can take three different values, and the random variable x can take five different values. This gives us a table of 15 numbers that sum to 1. Now, in general, these could be any 15 non-negative numbers that sum to 1. However, if x and y are independent, then this matrix is rank 1. That is, it can be explained by 8 numbers, 3 of which are for the marginal py, and 5 of which are for the marginal px. For a bivariate continuous distribution, then what we're looking at is a product of probability density functions. Here are two probability density functions for x and y, respectively, that I've sort of stretched out over the other axis. By making them flat along the other axis, I'm trying to convey the idea that they have nothing to say about that other variable. Then the joint probability density function is the product of these two functions. This is shown here by the orange surface. Closely related to the general concept of independence is the idea of conditional independence. We say that two random variables are conditionally independent given a third random variable if the conditional distribution over those two random variables given the third factorizes. Here we would say that x is conditionally independent of y given z if that conditional distribution can be written as the product of p of x given z and p of y given z for all possible z. Conditional independence comes up quite a lot when we're reasoning about latent structure in data. Here's a very simple example to illustrate the idea. Let's imagine that we have a sequence of customers coming into a store at which it's possible to buy an umbrella. We'll denote the event that customer I buys an umbrella as B sub I. Let's denote the event that it's raining that day as R. Here are some hypothetical probabilities connecting rain to whether or not a customer purchases an umbrella. We're going to make the reasonable assumption that people are more likely to buy umbrellas on rainy days. Let's also posit a marginal probability for it raining on any given day. Just to be clear here, we're considering all of the customers to be coming in on the same day, and customers are making random choices about whether or not to buy an umbrella based only on whether or not it's raining. From this, we can compute the marginal probability of any given customer buying an umbrella. Now let's look at the joint distribution of whether or not any two customers buy an umbrella. As before, we need to marginalize over whether or not it's raining. That is, we need to sum over R and R complement. When we work this all out, we see that the probability of two customers both buying an umbrella is larger than the product of the marginal probabilities. So here B1 and B2 are not independent, but they are conditionally independent given the knowledge of whether or not it's raining. So these are general properties of dependence and independence, but there are certain kinds of statistical relationships that warrant specific attention. In particular, we care a lot about the idea of linear dependence, which is captured through the idea of covariance. Intuitively, you can think of covariance as measuring whether or not two random variables both deviate from their means in a coincident kind of way. So if, for example, they both tend to be greater than their mean or less than their mean at the same time, then the covariance will be positive. On the other hand, if when one of them is above its mean, the other one tends to be below its mean, then the covariance will be negative. Here I'm going to show you an illustration of the idea of covariance on a cloud of data. When the data are kind of stretched out from the lower left quadrant to the upper right quadrant, then they'll tend to have a positive covariance. When the cloud is kind of axis aligned in the middle, then the covariance will be close to zero. When the cloud is going from the upper left to the lower right, then it tends to have a negative covariance. Now, a word of warning. Covariance only captures linear dependence. Just because something has a covariance of zero does not mean that the random variables are independent. Here I've constructed a slight twist on the cloud from before, making it a donut instead of a blob. When it's stretched out and thin, it still has a non-zero covariance. But notice when the donut becomes nearly symmetric, the covariance almost goes to zero. However, in no way are these two dimensions independent. If I tell you that the x dimension is zero, you know that with high probability the y dimension is near -2 or +2. But if I tell you that the x dimension is -2, then you know that the y dimension is close to zero. So clearly these random variables depend on each other, but the covariance is very close to zero. It's because their dependence is not a linear dependence. More generally, we often talk about covariance as a matrix rather than as a scalar. This is because in practical machine learning, we don't very often talk about just bivariate distributions. Instead, we talk about distributions on Rn, that is, over random vectors. So in this case, the covariance is a matrix that contains all pairwise covariances. This is a positive semi-definite matrix, and we usually write it as a capital sigma. We often write this compactly as the expected outer product of the deviations from the random variable and its mean. Alternatively, you could think of this as the expected outer product minus the outer product of the expectations. One thing that's a little bit frustrating about covariance is that it's unclear what range it can take. The maximum covariance between two random variables is a function of their scale, that is, of their marginal variances. But sometimes you want to talk about dependence without having to refer to a particular scale. For example, in cars, if I wanted to talk generally about, say, a relationship between gas mileage and horsepower, it shouldn't matter very much what units I choose for gas mileage. The Pearson correlation coefficient solves this problem for us by normalizing the covariance with each of the standard deviations. That is, the correlation is the covariance divided by the square root of the product of the two variances. This results in a value that's always between negative 1 and 1. The reason for this is you can think of the standard deviation as being a kind of linear scale for the random variable. So if you take the two random variables and divide them by their standard deviations, then you get new random variables that have variance 1. That is, you've made both of them essentially unit scale for purposes of computing the covariance. To give you an idea of what this looks like, I've created another visualization of a cloud of points. I'm varying both the covariance and the horizontal scale of the data. Note that the correlation shown in the upper left is varying smoothly from about 0.99 to negative 0.99. Note in particular that it's doing that even as I bounce the horizontal scale up and down. So this is reflective of the kind of behavior that I mean when I talk about the correlation being scale-free. So this is just a little bit of a taste of the way that we talk about dependence between random variables. It's a huge topic that informs a lot of different pieces of statistics and machine learning. And of course, many different kinds of scientific hypotheses are framed in terms of associations between different covariates. If you'd like to learn more about how a lot of these ideas inform machine learning, I suggest that you do some searches for probabilistic graphical models, which are a marriage of probability theory and graph theory for talking about dependence between random variables.